and welcome to Human Stories. My name is Liana Chua, and I'm a social anthropologist based at Brunel University in London. I've worked for many years with a small indigenous group in the hills of Malaysian Borneo called the Bidayuh. But in today's video, I'm going to be talking about my current research, which also revolves around another inhabitant of Borneo, namely the orangutan, and what different people think about it. Now, as I'm sure many of you know, orangutans are critically endangered today. They only exist in the wild on the islands of Borneo and Sumatra, and there aren't very many of them left. And so over the past few decades, there has emerged this really quite large and quite complicated global network of conservation scientists, conservation professionals, NGOs, and other bodies that are trying to save the orangutan from extinction. And so as part of my research, I currently work with four colleagues here at Brunel, Hannah Fair, Viola Schreer, Anna Stępień, and Paul Hasan Thung, to try to understand the different human dimensions of orangutan conservation. So essentially what we're trying to understand is how different ideas and people and resources move from one node of orangutan conservation across the globe to another, and what kinds of effects these movements can have on the ground. So each of us works on one particular node of orangutan conservation. And what I'm going to try and do in this video today is draw together bits of our research and our comparative analysis to give you some idea of what we've discovered. So what have we found? Well, we found lots of different interesting things, but I think the most striking of these is just how differently different people view orangutans around the world. Now, if you live in Europe or North America, for example, you're probably going to be very familiar with images like these. All these sorts of images and messages tend to portray the orangutan as this really special, really unique, endangered, charismatic creature whose rainforest habitat is severely threatened by things like deforestation, plantation expansion, and all sorts of other destructive human activities. And so a lot of the current work of orangutan conservation revolves around trying to save orangutans from the destructive impact of humanity. And much of this, we find, is fueled by this view of orangutans and rainforests as basically belonging to the planet at large, as being a kind of responsibility that the whole of humanity has to try and care for. And in our research, we found it quite interesting that this sense of responsibility has been an important motivation for individual orangutan supporters to do things like donate money, sign petitions, fundraise, and also try to make ethical consumer choices so that they too can help to save orangutans from a distance. So those are basically international perceptions of orangutans. But what I want to do now is take you over to the rainforests of Borneo and Sumatra, where orangutans actually live. And when we start to look at the situation in these areas, we find that there's actually a much bigger and more varied range of views. So first of all, we find that there is a view of orangutans as being important to the world, yes, but also being important national assets. They belong to the state. And so in this view, it is the responsibility of the Indonesian and the Malaysian governments to manage orangutans' populations. This is a view that can be found at different levels of government and also among local and foreign conservationists in Indonesia and Malaysia. And it's a view that takes the form of laws that make it illegal to kill or to harm or to keep orangutans as pets, as well as different policies and bureaucratic structures that try to protect and manage orangutans' populations and the habitats. And then when we turn to the communities who actually live in and around the rainforests of Borneo and Sumatra, we start to find even more variety. So for a start, there are some indigenous communities in rural Borneo that have historically had special relationships with orangutans, in the same way that other indigenous communities have had special relationships with other animals, such as crocodiles or fish or dragons or big cats. This is a fairly common cultural pattern across the island. So, for example, we find that in some Iban communities, you can hear stories of how orangutans once upon a time taught Iban ancestors to give birth safely. So there's one story that you can see on the screen. You also sometimes hear of how old Iban ancestors turned into orangutans and sometimes appear as these animals in the present. And so for these communities, it is basically taboo. It's forbidden for them to harm or to kill orangutans or to do anything detrimental to them because of this historical special relationship. But having said that, when we start to look at indigenous and rural communities more widely across Borneo and Sumatra, we actually start to see a slightly different pattern. And what we found in our research is that among most of these communities, there is a kind of marked lack of interest in orangutans. They're just not seen as very special or very interesting. They're just kind of there, you know, they're just one more animal that you might happen to encounter as you're walking through the forest, and that can actually be quite intimidating if you encounter up close. And so if, for example, a villager runs into an orangutan in the jungle, they might ignore it, they might avoid it, or sometimes they might hunt and consume it in the same way that they hunt and consume other animals such as snake or fish. So in that sense, the orangutan is very much kind of fair game in the jungle. In other cases, we might find that orangutans have entered villagers' fruit gardens or farms or their small plantations, in which case villagers might chase them away, they might attack them, and sometimes even kill them in retaliation for damaging their crops. There are also cases where villagers might take baby orangutans from their dead mothers to keep them as pets, as they do various other forest animals, or sometimes to sell them on into illegal wildlife trade networks. So essentially, for these communities, orangutans are just part of the general fabric of life in the rainforest. And so they don't see any particular reason why orangutans should be singled out by outsiders as being extra special or having to be extra protected. So as you can imagine, in a situation like that, tensions can arise when conservationists come into these rural areas. And tensions can arise, for example, when orangutan conservationists or other conservationists come into rural areas and try to restrict villagers' access to their ancestral lands or try to prohibit them from carrying out certain activities in these protected areas, such as farming or burning or cutting down trees, because they're trying to protect orangutans. Tensions can also arise when local authorities and rescue teams come into villages to confiscate orangutans from villagers who might be keeping them as pets and then taking them off to rehabilitation centers where, to many local eyes, orangutans are basically treated as pets. They're being cared for and fed and nurtured. And so in our research, we found that many rural communities find it extremely confusing as to why these outsiders, these conservationists and these government officials come in and spend so much time and put in so much effort towards saving one particular animal that they see as special, when they don't see orangutans as particularly special locally, when actually it's people like themselves, humans who live in the forest, who need food, who need medical supplies, who need money, and who need amenities. Why, they keep asking, do these people treat this one animal as so special? But these tensions are not just about orangutans. For many villagers, conservationists are simply one of many, many possible outsiders, which could include government officials, tourists, companies, NGOs, that come into their areas and bring with them potential opportunities, but also dangers. So in many cases, conservationists have brought benefits such as income, jobs, alternative livelihoods to rural communities, but they also pose quite a significant risk. And this is because conservation measures to protect orangutans' habitats, such as restricting access to people's land or restricting activities within protected areas, can actually have a very detrimental impact on villagers' livelihoods and lives. They can cause villagers to lose their customary lands, their livelihoods, access to their forests, their rights, their freedom to move within these places. And the thing to remember here, I think, is that for these villagers, rainforests are not just some sort of pristine space that belong to the planet at large or that need to be emptied of humans. They are actually their home in a very, very concrete sense. And as villagers' home, the rainforest is a place that they rely on, that they can own parts of, and that they feel responsible for. And so while these villagers are not averse to working with outsiders like conservationists or like companies, they're also quite understandably keen to make sure that these encounters are beneficial and fair to them. And so one of the biggest challenges facing orangutan conservation is working in rural areas in Borneo and Sumatra today is actually making sure that their efforts to protect orangutans' well-being don't have a negative impact on the well-being of the humans who also live in the area. And this is a tension that many organizations are extremely aware of, and they are working very hard these days to try and find ways of promoting sustainable human-orangutan coexistence. Okay, so what can this contrast in different perceptions of orangutans tell us about people today? Well, I think there are a few things that we can learn from this particular case study. First of all, I think this case study reminds us that what may appear to us to be the same thing, like orangutans, can actually be viewed in radically different ways by different people. And these sorts of perceptions are very often rooted in specific context. So for example, international conservation ideas tend to reflect a historically Western view of nature and culture as being these completely separate things that you need to be holding apart. Whereas for many indigenous Borneans, they really start out with this view of nature and humanity as being entangled to begin with. But I think it's also important to say that this isn't just a story of clashing contexts or clashing cultural perceptions. It's also a story of power differences and inequality. And these are factors that shape many different people's lives around the world today. Indigenous and rural communities in Borneo and Sumatra have very long histories of dealing with various outsiders who have not always understood or respected their land ownership, their forest rights, or their autonomy, their freedom. And this is partly why they become concerned about conservationists coming into the area and trying to change the way they live and use their land. But their voices can be very easily drowned out in a relatively well-funded and relatively influential conservation field that's really dominated by international perceptions of orangutans and rainforests. And yet it's these very communities that hold the key to the long-term survival of orangutans in the wild. And so I think the second thing that this example teaches us is that there's always going to be more than one side to any human story. And as anthropologists, it's really, really important that we keep asking whose stories are being told or heard and whose voices are being drowned out or ignored or glossed over. And this in turn means that as anthropologists, we need to keep digging. We need to keep listening out for those other voices, however vague or indistinct they may be, and finding ways to make them matter through our work. And we need to do this not only for the sake of humans and the people that we work with, but also arguably for the many non-humans that we share our world with. So that's all I've got to say about orangutan human relations. Thank you very much for watching. And for more interesting video content and other material, please don't forget to check out the Human Stories website. Cheers.
Peace and light to you and yours. So I sometimes